All right, welcome back, Whiskey Freaks. We're here tonight with, as always, Smoky Beast, Steve Zeller.
What's up?
Myself, Ben Paluba. And tonight we have the Whiskey Warrior, Jake Cahill, back with us once again.
Ha-ha!
The Warrior!
Rawr! Thanks for having me back in the
Warrior,
layer, guys.
Warrior, come out and play!
That's what he called me up, and that's what he said. Yeah. I didn't have to tell me what it was for. I was just here a half hour later.
Well,
I figured there was whiskey involved.
You jumped on your warrior chariot and rode in.
Yeah, I rode the lion that I slayed last time in the photo.
Sweet.
I rode that bitch all the way here.
Nice. Your speed flying lion.
Yeah, I had it saddled. It wasn't bareback. I'm not a barbarian.
All right. Okay. Not complete savage.
I don't even know about your
I live in Brooklyn, so there's this custom lion saddle shop around the corner from me.
Of course there is.
What is that? Lion tack shop? What do they call that?
Tackle.
Dude, we
tackle
make only hemp.
Yeah.
Lion harnesses.
Made out of all of the finest ecological materials.
I was into the English style lion saddle for a while, but now I just go Western.
That's a good reference. You know your equestrian trivia here.
Yeah. Right.
Slightly.
So what is this? Beastmasters Club podcast numero ocho?
Ocho? I think this will be the eighth edition of the Beastmasters Club podcast.
Right.
And our second time having Jake on, which is awesome. Glad to have you back.
Yeah.
Beastmasters Club. Experiencing the world's finest whiskey, one bottle at a time.
So tonight we're gonna be doing something a little bit of the capper on 2016. We're gonna be talking about things that are kind of going away after this year.
Clear the shelves.
Yeah, clear the shelves. Stock your bunker. Like, what do you need that will no longer be available?
Some people have stocking stuffers. We have bunker stockers.
Bunker stockers.
Yeah,
you're gonna need a much bigger stocking this year. Unfortunately, because this is a lot of really, really tasty whiskey that is going bye-bye.
It's so sad just looking at it here on the table, isn't it?
We're
gonna have to play some Oscar death montage music for each one. I'm gonna edit that in. We'll have Wind Beneath My Wings and
the tribute to all the dead Hollywood.
They're
folks
all wind.
On the
Why is it all wind? They're all wind references. Like
the wind means your soul is blowing the fuck away.
Okay. Nice. Yeah,
I think it's like life is gone.
And you know, when we get to certain distilleries that no one cares about, it's gonna be like, oh, Longmore and 16. Like, we'll just play that one real fast. That's the sound editor of the dead Oscar montage.
Sure, pick on Longmore. Jesus Christ.
We can't let people know about all
the
secrets.
It's recently deceased, man. It's too soon.
Sorry. I'm more of a kick it while it's fresh kind of guy.
So generally, right, the reason that you guys wanted to do this is because a lot of whiskeys are disappearing all over the place over the last few years. A lot of traditionally made stuff, things that have been around for a long time that a lot of great distilleries put out on the regular are now fading out or being replaced by other different styles of things that these same producers are making. So we wanted to figure out what do we need to get our hands on that we love that will no longer be made anymore. So we were trying to pick the top five
and the top one,
the top five going out of styles so that we can all vote at the end of this podcast and pick the top number one
bunker stalker.
Yeah.
I just want to piss off all the annoying Facebook whiskey hoarder people by publicizing all the shit that we should try to, that they're going to try
that should be kept to ourselves.
Yes.
And all that stuff. Well, you know what? That's not fair, because then all the power is going to be in their hands and they're going to sell it for $100 more than they bought it for. And it's just going to be ridiculous.
So let's let the general public in on the thing.
You guys go out and buy it for yourselves so you don't have to deal with the whiskey monopolizers on Facebook.
Right. If you're within earshot, get down to the store and stock up on these things if you can find them. And then you won't have to deal with some secondary market Facebook group jackass jacking you.
And if you can't find them,
we
call
already
us.
Did all that and bought them all. So.
So we have the closets full.
By second market hoarding jackass, I mean myself.
I am willing to sell any and all of these to you guys at 4x retail cost.
You can find Jake at Jake Cahill 13 on most social media channels.
There you go.
If you're looking for some outrageously marked up bourbon, rye.
Yeah, I don't even really drink this stuff. Personally, I'm more of a vodka guy. You know, this is just such a commodity right now. I just have to get
vodka
in on
warrior
it.
Doesn't really have the same ring to it.
Grey Goose or die. Bitches.
That could be your sidekick, like whiskey warrior and the vodka vagina. Or something.
Whoa, okay.
The vodka vagina.
You just went right into a strange dark place with that.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah,
and we lost.
But there 30%. Are, you know, there is that like a tampon vodka type thing that people do, the vodka vagina.
Oh, right.
Yeah. they dip the tampons in and they get wasted without having to actually drink stuff. Go Come right on. Into the bloodstream, divert the digestive tract. Oh, yeah. Crazy, like crazy Russians and who the hell knows.
We can edit that.
I don't know vagina. Anything
yeah, we're not,
about
we're not
this.
We're not going to keep that in. Like, that's why I'm going all the way with it. But people do that. Like you dip the tampon and girls will insert them.
Guys could do
in
it
themselves.
Too.
Yeah, sure. You can rectally enjoy yourself.
Jake's got one in there. I know.
Yeah, it's what I do all day. It's how I roll.
No, but the Whiskey Warrior thing. So again, I think we should reiterate that it's not just a title, but you actually did appear on American Ninja Warrior.
I did.
And I mean, can I spill the beans that season is approaching and the big audition tape is being completed as we speak?
It's being completed. Yeah. Oh. My body is broken. I'm hurting pretty bad right now. we've spent the last couple weeks putting together my next submission tape. Hopefully they'll let me back on this year so I can have a chance to go get a little bit further, work a little bit harder, and be the next American Ninja Warrior.
I think this Whiskey Warrior thing is like the, you know, the backstory you need. Like everybody's got their like random, like, you know, I'm an algebra teacher and I collect chia pets or whatever. They've got their like stupid 5 second
or like something tragic or whatever, which is like
cape and a chia head helmet or something.
They liked it last year. And I understand that it's a TV show. So, you know, I'm there for lots of reasons and mostly just to have fun. But, if I have to drink a little more whiskey on, you know, social media for them to think that I like whiskey a lot. Sure. Okay,
we're going to get the whole Beastmasters Club to entourage this shit. And we're just going to be
show
at,
up
at, A&W just wasted.
It's good. You know, just like
hammered flasks in hand, like waving our flasks with Viking warrior costumes on, just screaming your name.
Air horns. Just
100 dudes will show up. Ready to kill.
Like, how can I get kicked out of American Ninja Warrior? I bet it's not that hard.
Probably not. There's a lot of very fit people looking, trying to get rid of a lot of energy. So if someone needs removing, I'm sure there's people strong enough to take care of that. But a spoiler alert, if I do make it to the top of the warp wall this year on camera, I will have a bottle waiting for me at the buzzer, and I will be taking a very large sip of it.
That would be epic.
Yeah.
Totally.
There's a chance I might have to have a fanny pack on in order to bring that bottle with me to the finish line, but we'll see.
You just jack it in your cod piece there, you know, like.
Just be like the whole.
You have a little flask.
If I had the run muling the whole time.
Oh, man.
That'd be great TV.
You get like a special flask or something that you can mule up there.
I have a cigar-shaped flask.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. He just breaks out the whiskey tampon at the top.
I didn't really want
to. We should definitely skip this out.
I didn't really want to know anything about your weird cigar-shaped flask, but it's okay. We'll let it pass. It's a good effort.
I saw just a couple outtakes of the audition tape, and it's Diesel, man. If they don't let you in, then we're going to protest or something.
Yeah.
You know.
I'd appreciate that greatly.
American Ninja Warrior. Get him back on there.
Also, I'm just going to say, you were kind of kicked out on a technicality last time. And so they owe you a second shot, I think.
No comment?
I think. Personally.
I mentioned that this year and all that stuff. So I know it was such a small little thing. And I did prove that I was a contender because I had one of the fastest times tonight. Yeah. So I would love to get back there.
Well, we're using the tremendous sway of the Beastmasters Club podcast to publicize this message.
All 9 people who listen to this podcast are going to chime in and go to war for you. Don't worry.
Yeah. Thanks, Mom. She listens. She does listen.
Cool. That's awesome.
She does.
Yeah. Amazing.
She's not a whiskey drinker. What does she always say?
What's your mom's
I love
name?
The smell. Tastes like shit.
Body mouth on mom.
Yeah,
too.
She
I
does
love that
a little bit. But she's a churchgoer, so she gets forgiven every week.
Right. Yeah. Hey, that helps. Whatever works for you, that's what I say. But I'll take any advantage I can get. all right. So.
Clear the shelves. So,
yeah, on the clear the shelves front. What's going away? What are we looking at? What do we have before us? What's first?
So we got five American whiskeys here in front of us. We're going to drink through each one and maybe are we going to vote at the end? Is
that the story? Yeah, we're going to vote at the end.
For we'll mega bunker busting bunker stalker.
I mean,
yeah,
I
super bunker stalker.
So like this isn't a Smoky Beast versus the Whiskey Warrior like the first one was. We've put down our weapons today.
Formed a temporary alliance.
Yeah, because we both agreed that like this is a bigger issue at hand that needs to be tackled two monstrous whiskey lovers and Ben Paluba.
Yeah. There you go. Well, you know, somebody has to make sure that you guys just don't pick up the swords and go to war at any opportunity. So I'm here just to sort of moderate and lend support and to
it's like the end of
kids
when,
in line.
Of Batman versus Superman when the giant kryptonite monster comes and then they have to team up.
I just watched that.
Ben obviously playing the role of Wonder Woman.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Clearly.
Oh man. That's why he's got the tiara on. I thought it was just because he had a new daughter. Oh my gosh.
Listen. Yeah. Somebody's got to frame these flowing locks in the most gorgeous way possible.
The gold hot pants I can't explain.
Yeah, that's just things that I like, you know? Yeah. I just want you guys to see the package in all its brutal glory.
Oh, gosh. The Beast and I were happy to team up for this, but I do have a feeling that all three of us are going to probably have a different outcome. I mean, I don't know. Maybe we'll all agree on one, which would be unfortunate for us. Unfortunate, but like, you know, there's five great whiskeys here that are going to be much harder to come across.
I think one way or the other, we'll figure something out, and we will let the folks at home know like what to stock the bunker with.
Yeah.
And either way, you could probably buy all five and you'd be in good stead. Yeah. So wouldn't worry about it. But yeah, here we go.
Cool.
The two great forces in the whiskey world combining instead of duking it out for supremacy, but combining for your benefit at home.
Right. Let's rock now take a moment to remember the whiskeys that are no longer with us. Did you ever know that?
We should do that. My should hero. Just like, let's just take a moment. We'd like to take a moment of silence to commemorate the lost whiskeys of 2016. We should roll some crap music on that.
I'm totally putting all this schmaltzy music in.
Yeah, good.
All right. Well, okay. So number one, the Elijah Craig 12-year. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind. Never know who to cling to when the rain set in. And I would have
not Elijah Craig 12-year. I know. This was probably like the most talked about like publicly all year, like kinda since the beginning of the year.
How dare they?
Well, I mean, it is a great whiskey. It was what, $30?
Yeah.
And this was always my go-to. Like, if I want something a little nicer, if I'm gonna have a party and I want something a little nicer to make cocktails, to pour sippers, I always went to this one. And it also used to come in that awesome giant, like,
the 1.75
liter,
the by handle
Mongo jug of it.
God, those were so great.
Yeah.
Impossible to pour, but like, who cares? Yeah. It was amazing. This was on the back of every bar. Mm-hmm. This was in like every signature cocktail in New York, you know, in 2014, like, you know, just after like the bourbon was booming back and all that stuff. This was everywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, this was a staple. It is a staple. I mean, it's still, I mean, it's not really around anymore. So this was one that Elijah Craig took their stride with. So Heaven Hill knew that they didn't. I guess why do we think it went away?
Well, I mean, they
obviously it wasn't popularity.
The no age statement, small batch,
right?
I mean,
which they did slowly in phases.
You know, 12-year bourbon these days for $30, not so much a thing anymore,
right?
Which adds to the sadness.
Well, what's going on with that? Is it?
So
do you think it's because they know that they can get away with selling things at a higher price, or is it because they're just running out of 12-year bourbon? Like, what's going on?
I think they're running out. They must.
I think they were short on supply. This is something we should like talk about and get out of the way real quick so everyone understands this. Like, the whiskey industry is not something that, like, as soon as you have more demand, you can respond immediately.
Right.
It's one of those industries that you like, you have to see a trend going in the future. It's essentially like crude oil turning into gasoline. Like, you have to like predict what the market's going to be like in 10 years. And Yeah, and 12 years ago, nobody was drinking bourbon.
Takes you a year to like increase production, and you have to, it's a whole supply chain thing. I mean, it's a very complicated thing to increase when you're already at that scale.
Quality.
Yeah.
Like, if, I mean, you're someone as reputable as Elijah Craig. I mean, there's, it's not like it's a single barrel thing. You know, like you can batch together and help get people's palates more accustomed to things. But in general, you have a really inexpensive, really great quality whiskey that you want to keep the same quality and you want to keep it affordable. So how do you do that? There's no immediate answer you can do. You either allocate and cut back like Buffalo Trace has done with pretty much everything they make, including $14 ancient age, which is like an allocated item now and is impossible to get if you're a retailer or a bar. Or you can go to a non-age stated for a few years until you have enough 12-age stock, and then you reintroduce it with a higher price tag.
Well, I mean, so Elijah Craig, just to go through the thing, right? They did the 12, and then they used to have the 18, which was not an expensive bottle, and that was great.
It wasn't expensive, still a premium, but it was still under $100.
Yeah, it would be $60 or something. Yeah, or $70 or something.
It was amazing,
like that, and it was great. And then they did, and then they did a bunch of 18 private barrels, which were awesome. Like Brandy Library did one that was killer.
Yeah, they've gone all the way up. I mean, they still do,
I think. And then like, they started releasing, they did the 20-year, 21, 22, 23-year. And then now they've rolled back to 18, but now the 18 is like $160 or something, right?
Yeah, it's hard to find it for a good affordable price. So. They've got the Elijah Craig Barrel Proof, which we've talked about and we're all big fans of.
If you can get it, the best shit.
That's 12 years. It's not age-stated on the front, but it's age-stated on the back.
And what, party in the front, business in the back. Yeah, but I mean, we haven't heard that's going away. That would merit its own show.
They've actually just started releasing smaller bottles of it at the gift shop. Yeah, so they've
released half bottles of the barrel proof.
Yeah, like I think 200 ml, so like a little less than half bottles.
Right.
So
that just like a hipper that you can carry.
They just came out with this unbelievable. They just dropped another batch of
it. It's great. I mean, you know, and maybe they saw that was where their quality should be going for now. So maybe. So the evolution of the 12 year specifically, now they've got these great older age stated ones, as you were saying, like the 18, the 23. But this, the 12 year in particular, they saw this, they handled this really well. They took the 12 year off of the front. Everyone went berserk. Oh, where's the 12 year? It's not anymore. It's not 12 years old. It's going to suck. Because, you know, if whiskey's not old, it sucks, right? Sarcasm. But they kept the age on the back. So it was still small batch, and it was still 12 years old. But it didn't any longer say it on the front. Mm-hmm. So they're slowly phasing out the fact that it was 12 years.
But now it's not on the back. Now it's not anymore.
It's just a small batch now. So
And look, I have to say, small batch is good. I mean, I've had it. I think it's very good.
It's good. It's not as good.
But the problem with that is that is it going to stay as good? Like maybe they're blending in some different stuff, and then but now that there's no age statement, it means they can pretty much do whatever. I mean, I don't know. Heaven Hill's a great brand. Like I trust them to keep the quality
immensely.
Up,
yeah, but absolutely.
It's still sad that the 12 years going away because it was such a great deal.
It'll be back,
but it'll be more.
But
expensive.
It'll be back at a higher price tag.
Yeah,
right.
But it's such a nice whiskey, isn't it? I mean,
it is. Yeah, let's chat
a lot of tobacco on that.
I mean, it's beautifully dark. So this is proof down to 94 proof. Which I mean, most of us have seen what Elijah Craig Barrel Proof looks like, which is not filtered or
black
or,
as night.
You know, proof down.
Dark
and it is dark. I mean, and look at this. This is proof down to 94, and it's still dark.
Beautiful. Yeah,
It's got a beautiful amber like hue to it.
Gorgeous.
Love that color.
It's almost like the classic, the color of the classic trapped in amber, like something trapped in amber, an insect caught in amber.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
You know what I mean? It's almost like that classic amber color.
Like the freaky science collector guy who's got all these bugs and jelly.
Like Dr. Hammond.
Yes.
So this has, I mean, this, so I'm just nosing it a little bit here. It's like, it's really fruity. Really fresh. It's got this great kind of like cherry maple thing going on.
Cherry for sure.
Yeah, like a tart fruitiness.
Yeah, it's really fresh. I like that the proof's a little bit softer. You can really dig in there. I mean, it's an inexpensive whiskey that you can like really appreciate. On the palate though, the flavors explode. I mean, it's really flavorful.
It does. It goes spicy. It's very spicy. Goes into that kind of black licorice and chili peppers, and It's also got some chocolate and some more of the fruits and stuff like that. Yeah,
totally.
And a nice clean finish. Like easy peasy.
Nice and dry. I mean, it's like really well structured.
Mm-hmm. Balanced.
It's, yeah.
Covers all the bases.
It's not grainy at all. I mean, there's like a really nice marriage of
12 year.
The barrel and the whiskey. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It goes from kind of from sweet to dry. Like the nose is sweet and then the finish is not, it's almost a little on the sour side. It's got this kind of dry herbal kind of finish to it for me, which is nice because it's not overly, it's not cloying or anything.
Crisp finish.
Man, why is this going away?
Elijah Craig.
Yeah. Well,
bring it back.
I mean, hopefully they will bring it back. Even double the price. It's still pretty good, I guess, but. You know, and you wouldn't sneeze at paying $50 for this, $55 maybe. I don't know. So we'll see what they do. Obviously, we can't predict the plans of the masters of Elijah Craig, but hopefully they bring it back either in a different form or at a higher price or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's still cool, they are still doing private barrel picks of Elijah Craig, though. Mm. So those will range in age. So if you find a store that does good private picks, they might have one lined up with Elijah Craig. My buddy's store just did a pick, and it was 11 years and like 6 months.
Mm. There's people sitting at this table who might be trying to figure out a barrel from Elijah Craig.
Oh, whoop. We are. By the way, this is the one that has been hardest to find.
Yeah, well, it also got discontinued earlier in the
Way earlier in the year. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, like, you can still find the ones that have the 12 in the back. Mm. Like, they're not as, quote, collectible, but they're still 12-year-old whiskey.
The number 12 is on the back.
Dude. It's on the back,
instead of the front. I mean, come
and
on.
Who pays attention to the back?
Well, no, it's kind of good. It means, I like it. Yeah, I hear you guys. Yes, people are dumbasses, but it kind of helps people like us who know what it is, and we're not like, oh, 12 year, but we're like, yeah, that's what I
At
love.
Least they didn't the black just put a 12 label on the front to designate something that's not an age statement.
Mm.
Like, that's fucked up. You know what I'm talking
Do
about?
Do you see that being done?
Yes. Like certain brands.
Oh,
just put
my
like
God. Like Old Charter.
Number 8. And it's like they replace an 8 year. They actually just got sued for this.
Who? Old Charter?
I think so. I don't want to say that.
Okay.
Allegedly,
we don't know who it is.
There was a brand who replaced an 8 year age statement with a title with 8 in the title.
Yeah.
And just stuck it on the front. And they are that, now in a big right,
they
class
just,
action
They
lawsuit.
Just call it super 8.
Super old number 8.
Yeah. Well, so, yeah. I mean,
so
I'll.
Fucked up.
Yeah. I'll call it out. Like, I don't know if they're facing a lawsuit or not, but like, I'll call them out. Like, Buffalo Trace with Old Charter, like, they used to have Old Charter, like, 8 year on the neck tag. And all they took away was the YR. And it just says
just the same.
Old Charter 8.
Right.
Benchmark 8. Like, yeah. Like.
That's really splitting hairs with getting away with sort of official statements and marketing and not making false claims.
Yeah.
That seems like really, really splitting those hairs that they are going
dirty
for.
Pool, man.
Yeah, it's fucked up. And especially where, like, you don't need, there's no need for them to do that.
Yeah.
Like, their stuff is flying off the shelves everywhere.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
Why would they get into playing these kind of monkey around
Especially
games?
Buffalo Trace. Actually, they've been always been really honest and, like, cool about the whole, like, secondary market thing and whatever. Like, you know, they're doing whatever they can to crack down on it. And,
right.
You know, they have some of the most allocated stuff around. So,
sure.
I wouldn't really expect it from them, but, I mean, maybe they don't think it's as offensive as the consumer does.
You know, it's clearly not something a distiller would do or anybody in the whiskey side of the business.
Hell
it's
no.
Like some marketing person would
obviously.
Be like, oh, well,
yeah.
You know, we should just...
We want to keep sales up.
Right.
Yeah.
Splitting hairs.
And in the long run, obviously, it'll do the opposite. You know, people will be pissed off. I mean, can you imagine drinking something for 30 years? Like you're out there on your porch, like granddad, and all of a sudden you just drink something, you're like, that doesn't taste quite the same. And then you like look at the bottle and you're like, what the fuck? And that would piss me off.
Totally.
Well, unfortunately, I think that's happened to a lot of people over the years with like various brands, obviously.
Mm-hmm. And all kinds of different products. It's not like as if the whiskey world is alone.
No, of course.
In this kind of chicanery and nonsense. You know, there's fuckery everywhere.
Yeah. But this is a whiskey podcast.
So stock your bunker, so clear the shelves.
Chicanery and fuckery to the whiskey.
Avoid the
category.
Fuckery. Yeah, we're going to help you avoid fuckery and stock your shelves with some stuff you'll want to drink for a while.
We are.
And if, all right.
If you let us know if you find any more of this stuff on any shelves.
We'll
since we let you guys know.
We'll help you clear it.
Yeah.
If you see it, we'll back up a truck and help you clear any shelves that you can find.
We have a moving service.
Boop,
I can hear the Google typing right now. sad. Elijah Craig.
So yeah, we're gonna say goodbye to Elijah Craig, 12 years.
And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind. Never know who to cling to when the rain set in. And I would have liked to know you.
Alright, so the next two,
This is a sad one. This is a sad two.
Yeah. I think we can probably disclose the two, right?
So yeah, we can pair them up as a group.
Number two, Smooth Ambler, one of our favorite brands and producers and distilleries, are discontinuing. Well, they discontinued their single barrel rye, and now they're basically discontinuing all the source stuff.
Right? All the rye is gone. Also,
all the rye is gone.
Technically, they released statements like at the beginning of the year, if not maybe just a little bit earlier, saying like, rye sources are tapped. We don't have any more. Mm-hmm. We don't have any more. That's it. It's done. So the rye has been done for a year, maybe a little bit over.
Mm-hmm.
But about 2 months ago, they made a pretty shocking statement saying that they were going to discontinue the Old Scout 7-year bourbon, right? And the 10-year bourbon.
That's huge. Yeah, that is sad. That's like the Patrick Swayze of
of
whiskey deaths.
Everyone just started to realize how good it was. How sexy he could be.
Yeah. And they realized, like, he might not actually know karate, but it was still fun to watch him jump around.
Right. What do you mean he didn't actually know karate? This is bullshit. I'm out.
I know. Jake always watched Roadhouse for the realism.
Yeah. Jake is a big Roadhouse fan. Sorry, Jake. I know.
Big Roadhouse fan.
And everybody is.
Come on down to the Double Deuce.
you be nice.
You are the bouncers. I am the cooler.
You be nice until it's time to not be nice.
How will we know when it's time not to be nice?
I'll tell you.
I will tell you.
I may have just watched that like 2 days ago.
Yeah.
And
2 days before that.
Jinx, you owe me a bottle of Old Granddad 114.
All right. So here we are with Old Scout 7-year bourbon. So Smooth Ambler, 7-year bourbon.
Smooth Ambler, 7-year bourbon.
Yeah, Smooth Ambler, 7-year bourbon.
you were going to tell us a little bit about Smooth Ambler, right?
Just the quick overview of Smooth Ambler, because everyone recognizes the name Elijah Craig. Everyone recognizes Heaven Hill as this big, long-standing distillery. Smooth Ambler was only established in 2009. A lot of distilleries were established in the last, 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
But Smooth Ambler has won over the whiskey community. They've really taken our hearts. They've, like, our palates. Like, we trust them. We agree with their stuff. It's really good. They don't just make whiskey, by the way. They make, like, a lot of other really great stuff.
Mm.
And they also don't make some stuff that they bottle. Now, they act as a non-distiller product, right? So this Smooth Ambler Old Scout 7-year is an NDP.
Well, that's the Old Scout. They go out and scout for barrels.
So that's the whole thing behind the Old Scout. And they've got their own distillate, which we'll talk about in a minute coming down. Like, there's a small chance maybe that's why this got phased out.
I would assume so. It's not like they're going to stop selling whiskey.
they're certainly not. But, I mean, I know for a fact that with the rye, they lost. I mean, there was no more barrels to be had. How many NDPs are there right now? No, they never distilled. I mean, they are, but... that's not going to be ready for years.
Hmm.
Their focus was on bourbon with their distillate, from what I understand.
Yeah.
Bourbon is going to be very different than this bourbon. That was the point. Like, they wanted to kind of have them, be different things. But,
right.
There's dozens. I don't know, 100 different NDPs out right now. Like, throughout. And, like, where's it all coming from?
Like, MGP and...
Most of it, right? Now... What everyone has always loved about Smooth Ambler is that they've been so honest about it. I mean, it says right on the bottle, distilled in Indiana, bottled by Smooth Ambler.
Like, right. Yep.
They've always been 100% transparent about everything. And I think that's why the whiskey community fell in love with them so much. And it's undeniable that their stuff is really tasty.
I mean, John will tell you they just don't, they don't chill filter.
They don't filter a thing.
I mean, they filter just enough that there's not like
a mesh filter.
They pour it through a strainer.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Yeah, like, yeah. They keep it up. They keep it up proof. I mean, even the standard off the shelf stuff, like this is what 100 proof,
99
proof. Yeah. And they pick good barrels and they don't mess with it. And it's just straight ahead product.
Totally. It's a whiskey lover's whiskey. Yeah, like that's their thing. They're obviously passionate about it and they want to transmit that to people and give people something great to drink.
Yeah. You know? And also I buy this for $35 a bottle, the 7 year bourbon.
Where else are you going to get that?
A 7 year unfiltered, like 100 proof, delicious whiskey that you know where it's coming from. I mean, I don't know. This was always on my shelf. It was always one of the first things I broke out when someone came over. I was like, oh, you got to check out Smooth Ambler. Like, this isn't their stuff, but like, you know, like this is what they produce.
Yeah. And obviously I'm a fan. I mean, it was the first barrel that I bought.
Yeah.
And this private barrel program is amazing. The off the shelf stuff is great. You know, it's great. I mean, I wish great things for them and I'm happy for John Little and all the guys over there, but I am a little sad to see the old scout go. This was many bottles enjoyed over the years.
Yeah, so congrats to Smooth Ambler and their recent business dealings and acquisition situation with, who was that?
Pernod Ricard.
Yeah. So cheers to John Little and all the folks over there. Good job. And, you know, we're going to continue to love you. And obviously, whatever you're putting out, we're excited to see what's coming for the future. But we're going to shed a small single tear for the seven-year-old Scout Bourbon.
Which, and by the way, at the end of the run.
And rye. Rye gone, too.
That's number three. So number two is the bourbon, and number three is the rye.
So officially deceased from the Smooth Ambler Old Scout line is the seven-year rye, the seven-year bourbon, and the 10-year bourbon, which was 100 proof, which was also delicious. So those are gone at the moment, possibly to ne'er return. But talking with John Little was really cool. They're very excited about what's going on with Pernod. And the biggest thing about Pernod, they're going to stay pretty hands-off. Mm-hmm. What Pernod wants to do is help them grow and help them buy more barrels. So they do actually want them to produce more. They want them to get more contracts with, you know, distilleries.
So they're going to do contract runs and they're going to go back to sourcing?
Allegedly. Yeah. Like, this is all obviously still in, like, the
beginning. Yeah, in the news that came out, it sounded a lot more like an investment than a takeover.
It totally is. Yeah. No, John Little is still CEO. He's still a master distiller. Like, he's still running the show. It's just they now can take a sigh of relief and don't have all the financial burden. So, like, it's great to see people that we love and a distillery that we appreciate. You know, a lot of us talk about these guys like they're on this huge pedestal. They're probably making a killing because everyone loves their whiskeys. Like, these are still, like, hardworking blue-collar guys that, like, don't make a lot of dough. Mm-hmm. So, like,
and it's a tough business. You know, it's a lot of hard work and a lot of doing. There's a lot to get done to put this whiskey into bottles and get it to you. So,
and they're small. Their operation is, like, I don't know, 10 people deep at most, including gift shop. What's up, Val?
Right.
Shout
out.
And like now they can add 11 more jobs, which like in that part of the country is a big deal. So huge. Like the whole thing with Pernod Ricard was great. So maybe this will come back.
I hope so.
But it might not be the same because they might have a contract with a different distiller and stuff like that. So for now, deceased and long gone.
Yeah, we're going to just play some taps for Smooth Ambler, Old Scout, 7 year bourbon and rye and the 10 year.
Well, this bourbon is, I don't know, how do we compare it to the Elijah Craig? It's
different.
It's very different.
A little bit spicier on the nose. You get a little more like black pepper and stuff on there.
I would call it.
High rye is really coming through.
Yeah, I would call it leaner. It's not as fruity. It's not as big and sweet. It doesn't have that. Yeah, it's drier. It's leaner. A little more stripped down and spicy.
Still got that nice caramel going on.
Yeah, absolutely. But it doesn't have that big maple fruit or any of that stuff going on in it. It's a little more crisp just in general.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, there's so much LDI juice out there right now that like after a while you kind of start to taste a trend because they use the same mash bill for all like their bourbons all the way through, I think. And this is the high rye mash bill. It's like, I don't know, 33 or 2% rye, whatever it is. And that comes through. Just because it's mass-produced spirit and doesn't mean that, like, it's not good.
Sure.
It tastes great. But, yeah, definitely a little bit drier. For a 7-year bourbon, there's quite a bit of wood there to it, too.
Yeah. It's got a nice color.
So these guys are great. By the way, they've also introduced two new they've got two things that you can still get in the meantime while they're waiting to release their bourbon, which should be released sometime next year, which is a weeder.
Cool.
They've got their Smooth Ambler, the Contradiction.
Right, which is a blend of the sourced and the
Blend of a 9-year sourced and a 2-year of their distillate.
That's good. I've had that. It's tasty.
Really good.
It's good.
I've never had it.
It's got an elephant bouncing on a ball or something.
On a barrel.
On a barrel. Yeah.
It's a cool bottle. I've seen it.
Yeah, it's a great bottle. And it's delicious.
It's tasty.
But they just released, I don't know if you've had this yet, the Smooth Ambler American Whiskey.
Yeah, I haven't tried that yet.
Sort of replacing the Smooth Ambler bourbon because it's in the same price point. Here in New York, it retails for like $33 a bottle. So it's really good. A different marriage of spirits.
Generally, American whiskey, when a company puts out a bourbon and an American whiskey, I always like the bourbon better. But, you know.
It's essentially declassified bourbon.
Because of the barreling.
Because it's a rejuvenated barrel. It's not even a refill. They recharge it.
Oh, they recharge.
Yeah, the barrel's recharred. It's essentially
after it's been charred once, they char it again.
So once the spirit, once the original spirit was dumped,
no, I get that.
You know, it's been emptied and then recharred.
I didn't know they did that. I didn't know there was recharring.
I mean, sometimes they don't. They really don't. It was kind of an experiment that was done at a Tennessee distillery that is not Jack Daniel's.
Right.
Nickel.
Nickel. Something that rhymes with pickle.
Schmickle.
Yeah. Schmickle. Rickle.
So that's really good. It's a little bit lighter of a spirit, but like it's really flavorful. It's really tasty, and it's $32. So, you know, it's they still have something good and valuable in their wheelhouse.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But sad to see this one go. It's super tasty, really flavorful.
And they're doing a rum too. Is that out?
Like that rum is awesome. Yeah, it's really cool. They obviously don't make it.
They sourced some. Yeah.
They sourced a 28.
Oh.
And a 23-year-old Jamaican rum.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, nice.
It might be 28 and 25, but I'm pretty sure it's 28 and 23-year-old Jamaican rum from two different distilleries.
I got to get me some of that.
Blend it together. It's amazing. And they do it high proof, and it's like around $50-ish.
Wow, that's really nice.
Yeah, and it's not colored at all. It's like still super pale, really light. It's amazing.
I think I prefer the Elijah Craig so far. That's
scoring. Out of two.
Out of two. I mean, I like both of them a lot. There was just a little more richness going on there.
Pool and a pond. Pond's good for you.
We can, you know, doing like a direct comparison, the Elijah Craig is a little bit more well-rounded. Mm-hmm. It's a really nice sipper.
Totally. They're definitely different. Spicy versus sweet, I would say, almost, in this situation.
The Elijah Craig is the sweeter. It's got more sweetness to it.
More floral and fruity. And the Smooth Ambler is definitely a little more stripped down and spicy.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a...
They're both great drinkers.
Warm summer day or a...
I mean, Beast, you've had some of the craziest bottles that have existed on this planet. I mean, this is all stuff so far that's under $40. This all stuff that you'd gladly have on your shelf, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
This stuff is great, and like you gotta keep stuff around for drinking. Like, not everything needs to be a precious, tasting experience. Like, people just, you know, this is just bourbon to have on hand.
That's why I'm so sad to see a lot of these go.
Yeah, totally.
I buy a lot of drinkers to have around because, we drink a lot of whiskey here.
Yep.
But the thing with American whiskey is, like, I mean, I'm also a collector, but the stuff that I bought 3 years ago. I like feel bad opening now. Like any whiskey you bought 3-4 years ago for collecting purposes is now like thousands of dollars.
But that's the same kind of thing that's happening with this now.
Anyway, this rye is nice.
Yeah, we got
it. Nice.
So it's, rye becoming harder and harder and harder.
Yeah, where's the fucking rye these days?
No idea.
Well, just like we were talking about earlier, right? You can't just ramp up and create more 10-year rye, 7-year rye last year for this year. So with rye, like over the last decade, gaining so much in popularity and basically having been completely ignored and neglected for, you know, 70 years or more, basically since Prohibition, you just don't have the stocks. You don't have it available. Yeah. Very few people were making it. So now that it's become super popular and all of the stocks that were around have been exhausted, we're looking at a serious drought.
On this level, so the Smooth Ambler Old Scout Rye, which is a delicious 7-year rye sourced from LDI. Mm-hmm. So we're talking 95% rye, 5% malted barley. That is an extremely common mash bill nowadays mm-hmm. on the rye market, right? Mm-hmm. So who else can we think of that has this distillate? High West has this distillate. Templeton.
You got a Templeton uses
and then they
it.
Flavor it and lie to everybody. Right. But they have this distillate as well.
Yeah.
Bullet Rye is MGP. Is
this yep.
this right. tastes absolutely nothing like any of those other ryes.
Yeah.
Only because.
Again, they don't screw it up.
They unadulterated it.
Yeah.
Like they don't mess with it.
Yeah. And I think that's what they did right that everybody else did wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And they kept it at a good price. I mean, $45 a bottle, I think. Yeah. This is like the average of this stuff, which rye is more expensive to work with. So rye has to be more expensive. It doesn't have to do with age. It has to do with production. But like, this stuff's really good.
Really good.
Really tasty.
Yeah.
I will say this, though. It's not your typical Kentucky rye. Like, I know a lot of old school Kentucky rye drinkers that do not like this because it's too herbal. It's too dry. Mm. It's too minty. It's got this.
Well, they're used to not a 95% rye. They're used to like a 60% rye.
Right.
With some, you know, corn in there.
Mm-hmm. Totally. Well, and also, like, yeah. you know, their distillate is very unique, like the way it tastes. It is very minty. It's very like junipery and like fresh
pickle.
Herbal.
Some people say it's pickly.
Yeah. I tend to enjoy the higher rye mash bill and the spicier, mintier,
yeah,
leaner.
That herbal.
Yeah, so you like this stuff.
Yeah, I always have. I love this. Like,
yeah.
This is incredible. I would drink this all the time, day in, day out. And mm-hmm. that's exactly, I think, what it's made for
yeah.
and what it should be. And like, this is a great sipping thing yeah. that you could have on your counter, on your bar, in your kitchen, and serve all
totally.
Day, every day. And like, it's, you won't be disappointed ever. It's just an excellent rye. It's got the nice, like, sweet spice.
No, I love it. I mean, yep. the viscosity of it's beautiful. The color of it's beautiful.
Nice
it's
smell.
It's textured nicely. Yeah. I mean, do this with it. And the fact that, like, it was $40 for me. I'll put this in a cocktail. No problem. I mean, on the rocks.
Sure.
Whatever you want to do with it, man. Keep it in your freezer. Who cares? Enjoy it how you want to.
Super smooth.
It's delicious. Like, just go buy it.
Yeah.
A shitload of it. If you yeah. can find it.
No, that's a great, you know, you're right. I mean, you feel bad if somebody wants an ice cube and you have some nice bottle of whiskey and you're like, oh, you know, there's some right. stigma there with stuff like this. I mean, I wouldn't put ice out. In it, but go crazy. You
don't put ice in anything.
Sure.
That's true.
So are you saying that if you see this somewhere when you're walking around, you're in your liquor store, what should you do?
Clear the shelves.
You clear the shelves.
You clear the shelves.
Clear the shelves.
Clear the shelves. And
then you ask them if they have more in the back.
Clear the shelves. Ben.
So I actually, I'm not going to lie.
Clear. The shelves.
Wait, so you're saying if you see this somewhere, you do what?
You clear the shelves.
Oh, I didn't quite understand what we were supposed to do.
And then you save one for us. I actually did clear the shelves of this once. I'm not gonna lie. This is a true story. I went in, and it's the only time I've ever done it. It was like, I don't know, 4 months after they announced that it was done. And this stuff was hard to find in New York City for like less than 60. But I don't know why. I just couldn't find it for a good price anywhere. And I found it at a store for $40. They had 7 bottles on the shelf. And I asked, hey, do you have any more in the back? They said, we have 1 in the back. I bought all 8 bottles.
They're out there. I mean, I bought this bottle for this show for $45, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Just went and found it a week ago.
Cool.
Not that hard. I mean, if you look around a little bit, they're out there. Not that they will be after this podcast. So.
Yeah, well, that's what this is all about, clearing the damn shelves.
Go buy more rye, John Little.
Yeah.
I wish.
Yeah. John. Bye, rye.
bye, rye. I mean, I don't know what else there is to say. It's just really good. Go buy it.
Yeah, go buy it.
And if you don't buy it, just call us and tell us where it was. We'll go buy it. That's fine.
Yeah, send us a note.
Old Scout Rye.
We're just going to be driving around the Northeast actually with a truck clearing shelves for the rest of the year.
So a toast off to Smooth Ambler. You guys have done a great job. We're sad to see some of our favorites from you go, but we are happy to see you guys progress, and we can't wait to see what you guys have coming for us, because you've told us that you have more coming. We don't have to guess.
Hell yeah.
Oh, there will be many good things from them, I'm sure. Yeah. But yes, it's the end of an era. Shall we move on?
So long, West Virginia. We're on the road to Kentucky.
Okay. All right. Heading out.
Old Granddad.
Yeah, man. So this is a bottle that's been around for a long time. So we're moving on to this beautiful squat little bottle with the widest mouth ever. Old Granddad, 114.
114.
Squat little bottle with the widest mouth ever. I'm going to refrain.
My partner Ben fits that description.
Yeah, that's me, baby. Yeah. I'm going to refrain from commenting on that because it's just too damn easy. I knew a girl like that in high school. But,
yeah. Oh.
Oh.
I mean,
so this is
it's a fat cork.
It is cool. Yeah, it's one of those corks that if like you break, you're not gonna have anything to replace it with. Like you just have to drink it that night. So this is what's sad about this. This is really and has been for a long time like one of the best kept secrets for bourbon lovers.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not even a secret, because like you tell people like, oh, you like Old Granddad, or like you like good and expensive whiskey, go buy Old Granddad 114.
Yeah.
Like, so I bought this for $25 in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
That means most places in the country probably find it for the same price. It's $25. Let's not even talk about quality yet. 114 proof.
For $25.
It's a cheap way to get drunk as hell.
Thank for your buck. Like, you're much better than that.
Well, yeah, man. Yeah. You know, I mean, this is $5 less than the Elijah Craig 12. I don't know what the age on it is. I'm pretty sure it's about 7 to 9 years. Not sure.
It's got to be. It doesn't taste like young.
It's not. There's still a bit of barrel on it.
Yeah.
It's dark.
It's nice and dark. It's a beautiful presentation with Old Granddad on there.
Yeah.
Is that a person? Is that like a specific Old Granddad?
It is a real person. I forget. I really should have Googled this before this.
Kind of like George Washington.
I think it's actually Elijah Craig.
Yeah.
It might be. If not, some people listening to this right now are going to be like, that dude doesn't know a damn thing.
What the fuck are you talking about?
I know it's somebody that was extremely important in the whiskey industry, and I forget who, but it's not Old Granddad. So Old Granddad used to be distilled by national distillers until late 80s, early 90s, when they shut down and started lobbying off their brands to other distilleries. Jim Beam won the Old Granddad name in that lobby. So they took over the Old Granddad line.
Right.
So I think officially after 1992, Old Granddad was being distilled by Jim Beam, even though they still had some national distillers
stock
juice left in it, right?
Okay. The Old Granddad is Basil Hayden Sr.
It's Basil Hayden. I knew it was someone.
Yeah, sure you did.
I did.
So you thought it was Basil Hayden's
Elijah Craig.
I knew it was somebody else that had another whiskey bottle.
So wait, so Basil Hayden Sr. is Old Granddad.
Old Granddad. His Old Granddad.
Yeah.
Cool. I can't remember. So this is really fun. So now it's distilled by Jim Beam. Obviously, Jim Beam, you know, Basil Hayden, whatever.
Yes.
They're really big. It's very different than it used to be in the 80s, back when it distilled by national distillers, but still really good. I mean, Old Granddad bonded. It's a great $18 bourbon, you know.
Sure.
One and of again, the old now classics. People seek out the NDP. Old Granddad's.
The national distiller stuff is like so special. I mean, really, it is. I just actually had some earlier today, and it was wildly different than the Old Granddad that we have nowadays. But that's for a lot of reasons.
I did a 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s tasting of it, the Old Granddad stuff, which was pretty cool.
And it evolves.
Yeah, I mean, it's totally
drastically
different.
Yeah.
The old ones are that, you know, musty kind of like that old character.
They were thicker.
Really
it's
interesting.
Just totally different.
And then it like totally breaks when you get to the like similar 90s. Nashville. Like it just flips over and it just tastes completely different.
Yeah, it does. It tastes a little bit more sharp, a little bit less rounded. It's not as fat. Jim Beam was using stainless steel at that point, and I'm pretty sure national distillers We're using either cypress fermenters or it might have been Oregon pine, but like I'm pretty sure it was cypress.
Right.
So they were doing a bunch of these things that would help give their whiskeys a little more viscosity. They were aging their whiskeys a little bit longer. The mash bill pretty much stayed the same. So this is actually Jim Beam's like high rye mash bill. Mm-hmm. So that gives it a little bit more of spice too. So this is like everything Basil Hayden wishes it was.
I mean, can you imagine if we took this $25 bottle to like a one of those craft distillery like events, yeah. You know, and like threw it up against some $80
some bottle. $70, $80 gosh. Bottle. Yeah. And they're like, what is that? And you're like,
wow.
We just put it in some hipsterized design bottle and just started being like, yeah, this is our, you know, Slipshot bourbon.
Bloody ankle.
Yeah.
It's bottled by Kurt Schilling. Every bottle.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's really
good. Kurt Schilling farted in every bottle.
Gross, dude.
It is delicious. I mean, it holds its own.
It just takes giant dumps.
It does, right? So this is like, okay, so let's get into like the smelling. And smells great.
It's way sharper. I mean, for sure. It's
$25 whiskey.
Yeah. I know. I'm not casting aspersions.
But we should be. I mean, we should still judge it on the same scale as we would judge any whiskey. Absolutely. It does smell a little bit sharper. It's a little bit harsher.
But now it's 114
proof. Like on the, I'm sorry, this is really approachable for 114 proof.
Hell yeah. It's great. I mean,
it's got a bite. It's got a little of that strong liquor finish for sure.
Sure. But I mean, I'd sip this. And to think about making cocktails or, you know, putting it on the rocks or something.
This would be an awesome Manhattan.
Yeah.
You can't go wrong. Great old fashioned.
Put this in a Kentucky Mule, that shit'll kick right back.
Mm. Hell yeah. No, I think it's interesting though, because if you're stocking your bunker and you have a limited amount of funds, you could get twice as much of this as you could of bourbon as a Smooth Ambler. So if you're on a budget and you're stocking, stock up on this because this is going to make your buck
clear
stretch.
Clear a whole shelf.
If you really want to clear them shelves, you can clear
a shelf of 10 bottles for 200 for the price of one Michter's 10 year.
Yeah. You know? You're a winner.
So you could, by the way, we should.
No offense to Michter's.
Michter's, we love you, but.
You know I'm a fan.
For fuck's sake, man, it's expensive. Worst Scottish accent ever right there.
Oh, that was Scottish? No. Jesus, I thought that was Irish.
Retarded? I think it was just terrible. Retarded.
It was awful.
Brain damaged human.
I don't know why they're doing away with this. I haven't been able to talk with anybody at Jim Beam. I just found out about this a couple weeks ago. I know that they did away with the handles. Like they stopped making the 1.5s of like the regular, old granddad earlier this year.
Yeah.
But then all of a sudden, and this went under the radar, which I'm really surprised about, because if you take a poll of most bourbon drinkers and you ask them what's their best like value bourbon, a lot of times this is in their top three.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I haven't heard any public outlash. I haven't heard like the outcry that we heard about like Elijah Craig.
Like Chuck Cowardy did a thing about it. Like there was some hubbub. But yeah, I mean, and also why not just, I don't know, raise the price by $10 or something, you know?
There must be a greater reason.
It's just a different proof.
I don't know.
Still going to release the 101, right?
They should release the bonded.
Do you think this is just big corporate strategy at Beam Suntory and they're like figuring out, what are we going to carry? What are we not? What can we still support? And somebody's just like looking at numbers and saying, how much of this do we sell? What would people not miss? Do you think this just gets caught in the shuffle?
I mean, maybe they sell a ton of this stuff, though.
I mean, I don't know if they sell a ton of 114, because I have a friend who's been drinking Old Granddad for years and he loves it. And I was like, you like the Old Granddad?
Never heard of it.
He's like, what's that?
Right.
And like, I was like, oh shit. So like, not a lot of people do know about this. That's why it's been such a great kept secret.
Mm-hmm.
But now that secret is going to go away. So like, I want it. Like, I want all of it. Like, I'm going to buy every last bottle I find.
Clear the shelves.
But I don't know. I mean, why would Jim Beam do this? It's not expensive for them to make. I mean, maybe they didn't want to drop the quality on it and it's a huge demand.
To me, it really sounds like a bean counter somewhere at Beam is looking at sheets and saying like, are we still making this crap? Do we sell any of it? Who buys it? What are the allotments? Distributors are coming back and saying, we don't want to carry this crap anymore. No one buys it. Who knows?
I mean, it's clearly There is some nicely aged whiskey in this for the price point. And that seems to be the trend here, right? It's like it's just not maybe that realistic anymore to be able to, because you can just taste it. You know, there's some, it's some 7 year.
It's not young.
5 year stuff. I mean, it's not a 2 year whiskey. There's no way.
So old granddad 114. We love you well.
Yeah, and I love you, man. And this is like beautiful and nutty and golden and honeyed. Yeah. It's just, it's really good. A little rough around the edges, but like in all the right ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, honey and nuts is a good description of this one. Yeah.
Like a honey nut Cheerio, yeah, baby.
Nuts for nuts.
It's the honey of an O.
55th and Broadway. And every other street corner in New York City.
Those candy stores where you go to get nuts like for
nuts.
Stale,
no, those nuts, just the roast nuts, the honey roasted nuts.
You can smell from
street.
Like 9 blocks away.
Those street nuts.
Smells toxic.
Always smell amazing, and then you buy them, and they're just vile.
The most disappointing thing of all time.
The street meat, too. They're somehow they get the smell right. But then
there
you,
are
you
some good
mouth,
striat miats, but not many. Striat
miat.
No, I'm talking about like the kebabs, you know, those.
There are a couple of carts that I have experienced that are legit, but yeah. Most of it is not really rat. For human consumption.
Yeah, it's like mostly rat, probably.
It's a rat pigeon combo. It's rat and pigeon. Would you like the rat surf shawarma or the pigeon shawarma?
Also, would you like white, yellow, off white, or red sauce on that?
Yeah. Hey, you know, don't mess with the white sauce.
So how, out of curiosity, is this something, old granddad 114, is this something you guys would drink neat, something you'd have on the rocks, something you'd put in a cocktail? How would you guys enjoy it?
I mean, I'll drink turpentine neat, but no, I would drink this neat. It's not bad for a sipper. It might not be my first choice to sip on, but I mean, especially for a high proof cocktail, this would be awesome.
I was going to say for a cocktail, you know, I mean, it's for the price. Clearly, it's the winner of the whole game, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you can, for $25. Now, there's 12 glasses of whiskey in a bottle, so you know, I can splurge and spend $3 a glass for a sipper. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
If I'm going to drink something neat, you know, I might bump it up to the, you know, something else.
Yes. Yeah. Totally.
But for a cocktail, you know. For a cocktail, for something on the rocks, for just, yeah. I mean, it's damn quality stuff.
Yeah, hell yeah.
It's better than most stuff that you're going to drink, even that's labeled at twice the price.
Yeah, like, yeah, for sure.
It's a great find, and if people are out there and see it around,
clear the shelves. Are we done with the OGD?
Yeah, adios, old granddad.
Granddad.
Yeah, later granddad.
Rest in peace.
Old granddad finally kicked the bucket what we're talking about. Yeah.
No, I mean, we're still.
He had a good run. He had a good run. He lived a good life. He made a lot of people happy, you know. But he's passed on now.
Give us back old granddad 114. Yeah,
bring
how dare you,
granddad. Yeah.
Get rid of some of your other.
Unlike most old granddads, Beam actually has the power to resurrect this old granddad.
Yeah.
And bring
stop spending money on paying Mila Kunis, who is hot, to talk about your bullcrap black barrel sucked out of the stave.
Let's
nonsense.
Just stop for 1 second. Has the whole whiskey marketing world basically now boiled down to Mila Kunis versus Matthew McConaughey? Is it like smoking hot chick versus super hot dude? And they're both like, they're kind of different, going to attract very different audiences, different people. Different people like them for different reasons. But is it like Wooderson versus like the nasty girl from Black Swan? Is like that what we've come to?
I guess so. I don't know. If that's the contest, I think he's got it nailed because her commercials suck.
Her commercials do suck.
Beam's Rack House, every barrel sits along 4 years. And then there's this crazy CGI thing where the barrel deconstructs itself and flies through the camera. Yeah, and it's silly. Like, you serious?
And like you get Matthew McConaughey and he's like, no, guys.
Yeah.
I just really want to talk about the bourbon.
Yeah. Has he done an actual commercial yet? He did a video, a viral video.
The stuff that I've seen is just like his crap bag Lincoln commercials.
I love those Lincoln commercials.
He's like, I was driving a Lincoln before I did this ad. And it's like, no, you weren't. before what are you talking it
was about? Cool, like it's right. cool now.
Never even been in a Lincoln. Other than when the town car comes to pick him up and take him to the show that he's doing that morning. Like, you're on Good Morning America. Maybe then. They probably even send a nicer limo for him. But really? Come on.
I mean, we all know he's more of a Chevelle guy.
I don't know. I dig the McConaughey turkey thing. Because if you're going to pick a brand, turkey's your turkey, right? Turkey's your pony.
On that level, that size.
And I saw his video he did with Eddie was cool.
Yeah.
And like, I think I want to have McConaughey on the podcast. That's like our ultimate goal.
It would be huge.
I'll shoot him a text. I'll see.
You know,
he's going to come in eventually. We'll get him. Don't worry. We're gonna do a special McConaughey Beastmasters,
but not Kunis.
World tour.
She's not welcome.
I mean, I think it'd be fine.
I'm totally willing to do that podcast just with her.
Sure.
Like, you don't have to come. It's all right. Like, don't even worry about it. We can do a private audience, a little private tasting. Me and Mila.
Mm-hmm.
No, I have no worries about that. It's okay.
Is Ashton Kutcher going to get a whiskey brand now? He's got it, right?
I hope so. You know, it'll be like...
I mean, if Drake's got one.
Does he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's Drake's whiskey?
Oh, yeah.
The Black Diamond. What the hell is it called?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's like... Obviously, it's 40 proof. It's 40% alcohol. 40 proof. It will be 30 proof.
But that's their whole selling point. Like, it's smooth. It's the smoothest whiskey on the market or something.
And what is it at?
Brown vodka.
80 proof? What?
Yeah.
It's just really low. I mean, it's bullshit sourced... You know, like horrible mass-produced whiskey.
Send it back. Right. I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Drake. All right.
Should have spent all of his money on his dance moves, but instead he spent it all on some crazy bottle.
He probably didn't spend a nickel.
Whatever. We're gonna edit all this out anyway.
But yeah. All right.
Cool. It's Virginia Black.
Virginia Black.
Yeah. Ginny Black. All right.
You're from Canada. Stop putting Virginia.
Yeah, he's from Toronto. He's a half Jewish dude from Toronto. Let's stop it.
Wheelchair Jimmy, what was his name? Degrassi.
Oh, God.
Let's not forget where he started. After Canada.
He was on the Degrassi 2, right? No, like the second Degrassi.
Yeah, I don't know. Whatever. They're
he's way too young to be on the first one because the first one, those kids were older than me. Like, I remember when I
would have remembered if Drake was on that. No, he's on
he was on the second.
The next generation.
New Degrassi Junior High.
Virginia Black. Decadent American whiskey.
All right.
We need to move on.
But
there's a phone number. Order Virginia Black. I've never seen that before.
We have a phone number for Beastmasters Club. No one's ever called it.
Do we do? We have a phone number?
Yeah, I got a Google Voice line. It's on the site.
I think I'm going to call it.
Call it now. Like, we should just put the message on right on the podcast.
I think,
like,
I pranked you guys once.
Is it like,
I think mine's like, hello, you've reached Beastmasters.
Beast Snatch or something?
No, it's just like a 646 number.
Snatchers.
We should call it right now. Here, I'll do it.
That'd be sweet.
I'm going to do it. Hold on. Live for the podcast.
Anyway, while you do that, so I brought this list while you call the Google phone account you set up that nobody else has. This may be the saddest moment.
I don't think anybody's ever called. Well, we don't have to say that.
Anyway, this last one is not actually dying.
Well, though it's going to. Whatever. That's a biased
opinion. I have brought Booker's bourbon because it is going from a comfortable $43 to $100.
Right. Madness.
It's literally confirmed. So wholesale price, like, for the people getting, so like when you see Booker's next year on the shelf for $100, don't freak out at the store clerk. It's not their fault. Like,
right.
Unless it's an older bottling, then they still bought it for $40 and they shouldn't be selling it for $100.
That's our Beastmasters. That sucks.
I thought they had a message on there.
Put it up to the mic.
Maybe here.
You have to say your name so they can't connect you.
Maybe it answers now.
Is it calling you right now?
No, I hope not. the universe might explode. It's probably trying to call me.
This is gripping radio right here.
Rip-roaring podcast adventure.
Hi. You've reached the Beastmasters Club. We're not able to answer your call right now, but if you leave us a message, we'll get back to you as soon as we can. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Sweet.
Bye-bye.
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 Did you have a voice alter? Like,
no.
On there? Dude, you were trying to make that like as manly as possible.
There was a slight...
Not at all.
Testicle circumference razor effect.
used on that one.
Bye-bye.
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 Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Hi, you've reached Beastmasters.
Thanks for bye-bye. Flying Beastmasters Airlines.
Suck it.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye. We should have done, you have failed to reach the Beastmasters Club.
That's the theme of the night is bye-bye. All the whiskeys are going bye-bye.
We're going bye-bye.
I feel like the cohesion of this podcast has gone bye-bye. Yeah.
Well, okay. Anyway, so Booker's Bookers.
Bourbon. Bye-bye, Bookers.
Booker's Bourbon.
Bye-bye, Bookers.
Yo, you're, Bookers.
No.
Well, I not mean, going away, but just the price is doubling.
So Bookers, as I knew it.
As we know
as
it.
I knew yeah. her. It was something you would buy in a bar when they didn't have any of the other whiskey. There's nothing wrong with it. But like, you know, you'd go to a bar and somebody'd be like, well, you're the whiskey guy. What should I drink? And I'm like, I don't know. Fucking drink the Booker's, you know? Like, it's good. It's cast like, strength.
For you, you'll be Booker. Like, holy shit.
That's what I mean, like,
for you, the
get,
Booker's is perfect.
Not to get all snobby, but it's like you're like you express an interest in something. You start writing reviews. You start a podcast. You do this or that. Like, people, wherever you go, are like, oh, well, you're the yeah, man. You're the whiskey guy, you know? They're like, they put you on the spot. And it's like, look, if I had a person who was like a big food critic, I would not bring them to Burger King and ask them what I should order. You know what I mean? Like, well, what do you recommend? You're the food guy. Should I get the Big Mac or the...
Right. No, you go to some corner bar that has no selection and they're like, show me what the best whiskey is.
Right.
So are you comparing Booker's to like Burger King? Like, do you think this is the fast food of whiskey?
No, but I'm just saying, like, it's good, you know. It's, you can get it at a bar and it's affordable, good. It was like a standard for me.
You can find it, you can find it everywhere. It's affordable,
nice quality, always there, right? Always, you know,
it usually retails between 50 and 70 bucks here in New York. That's what, yes,
I don't know, I've never really, I haven't seen it for that much, but
70,
yes. Between $50 and $70.
But I thought this is like a $50 bottle.
I mean, let's talk about what it should be priced at. It should be priced at between $50 and $60. Okay. The cheapest price I've seen it at in New York City over the last 3 years has been $53.
Well, it shan't be hard for our listeners
or 50 or whatever
to go online and find it for probably $43 today.
Of course.
As of the time of this recording.
And you should. So we need to talk about why they're on the show.
Well, it's a great bourbon. Particularly this year, they started to they have six batches. What, last year they started this? Jake's signing me like, you're a moron.
He's like, dude, stop fucking it up.
Anyway, they started kind of tagging these batches. They started with, it was like the Round Table, the first stuff they started doing.
Started doing the Round Table in 2014, where so they still had the old school tag on it, but like basically. Fred Noe started calling in like well-respected members of the whiskey press and whiskey bloggers and people that really like whiskey to kind of help him pick a batch. And the Booker's Roundtable pick, which was one batch of the year, which there's usually about six batches throughout the year or so, they've said that like those are like an amazing batch because they're picked by this committee and blah, blah, blah. Personally, I trust Fred enough to pick the batch. Like, I don't know why he needs anyone else to tell him what the hell's going on. He's the master distiller. His dad was the master distiller. Their grandpa, like, I trust him.
Generations of.
So whatever, like they started, but in 2015, they started doing this really cool marketing thing that did not raise the price at all. The bottle pretty much stayed the same. The box got a little bit darker. But the label, they all started having images on them with names. So as opposed to being
bluegrass,
you know, 2014-C, you know, -18, which no one aside from certain whiskey nerds actually knows how to decode these, like, you know, old school things.
And Anise Seltzer and the bluegrass edition.
Right.
And
so they started having like, all these, you know, nose secret and center cut and blah, blah. And it was a fun marketing thing. Honestly, like, it was a really smart way to appeal this whiskey to people. And I thought it was great they did that.
Yeah.
I even caught wind of it. I was like, oh, I want to have one of each. Like, it's cool to have.
Right. And there are differences, subtle, but there are definitely differences between the batch.
Yeah, totally. Absolutely.
And there are some that I like. I mean, I like the bluegrass batch a lot. And you can kind of collect them and they have the picture on them. It was smart. And it was great because they were still, you know, 40,
same price.
45 bucks.
Same
whatever.
Price. Stronger box.
Right.
Like, seriously, the box was better. It was like a whatever. It was a finished colored wood. Like, it wasn't like a you know, piece of bark that they just carved off a tree.
Well, okay, I'll be honest. I bought a case of Booker's just because it's gonna suck. Because, you know, I might want some for a tasting. I'll have some for drinkers around. It's not my everyday favorite bourbon, but like, I like it. And for $42, I was like, I should just get a case of it because clear the shelves, right?
Clear the shelves.
But my problem is I drink it a lot at bars. So what is it going to be? If it's $100 a bottle, that means it's going to have to be like a $20
glass. $20 sip of Booker's in a bar?
Sucks.
Basically, this is the gist of it. I mean, we should get to some tasting notes in a minute. But for $50, I've been a longtime Booker's fan and will be as long as I can keep buying this $50. Mm-hmm. As soon as this becomes a $100 whiskey,
gotta run away.
Sorry, like, I'm not buying it anymore.
Yeah,
like, I will not buy a bottle of Booker's for more than $70.
Do you think they'll face that issue? Do you think
Absolutely. Do you think that
their sales will drop hard when they raise the price?
Hugely.
Like, and like, honestly, you think they're just gonna cut back production and keep it and like keep it as a more premium thing, or like what do you see happening there?
I think that this has been the best advertisement for Booker's. Maybe. In 20 years.
And maybe you're wrong. Maybe people will line up to buy it at $100. Who knows?
I don't know, man. Maybe have you been on Instagram in the last week? Every single whiskey blogger, every single person that drinks bourbon has posted a photo of Booker's in the last week and a half since they announced it, and has been like, God, I'm going to enjoy this while I can, because Lord knows I'm not going to buy this shit for $100. So, like, everyone, yeah. Seriously, this is the most press Booker's has gotten in 20 years.
I hear you. But what are you going to buy for $100? Let's say you want to go out and buy a $100 whiskey.
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to buy? A $100 bourbon or American whiskey, even rye, bourbon, anything.
What would I buy?
What are you going to buy? Yeah.
I mean, Michter's 10. You're talking about stuff like
that. You can't get Michter's 10 for $100 anymore.
Because you're talking about like at a normal level, stuff that you can find.
Stuff you can walk into a store and buy. Like,
go to a store and spend $100 on a bourbon.
Smooth Ambler 10. Oh, wait. Elijah. Oh, wait.
Right.
See?
That's what's starting to happen. That's exactly what we're talking about. And
spend a little extra money to get for somebody or a special occasion.
Rock Hill Farms. Gosh, even that stuff's being harder and harder to find.
Yeah.
Blanton's is good. That's a good choice. Blanton's
is like a dated.
I like Baker's too. That's good stuff.
Baker's is good too.
But yeah, Blanton's is a good choice. I mean,
there's a bunch of stuff out there. I mean, you want to call it. I mean, go get a fucking bottle of Contradiction for $50 and go support someone that's smaller and needs the money.
Sure, but I'm saying maybe there's a niche in the market at that $100 level for like a primo. Because, you know, if you're, let's say you're a malt drinker and you're going to buy your Glenmorangie or your Talisker, whatever, you're going to buy your $50 bottle, and then you want to go up to your $100 bottle, there's a ton of options to buy there, right?
It's true.
Like, you get your 18-year, you get your this or that, 100 to 150.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, in malts, too, like, you want to spend $200, there's a ton of options. You want to spend $300, there's a ton of options.
Right.
Bourbon, it's basically, like, $50 or $1,000 at this point.
Well,
can't spend $200 on a bourbon.
I think, again, we're right back to that supply and demand situation. With malts, this guy's been socking away tons and tons of stuff at all kinds of different age points and tons of barrels all over Scotland that they can put out at all different kinds of aged releases. So, you know, the same distilleries are made. They got an 8-year, a 12-year, a 10-year, a 15-year, an 18-year, a 24-year. So they cover all those different price points with all that different aging. But, you know, 10 years ago, nobody thought that there would be such demand for bourbon. So it's just not sitting around. They literally don't have it, I think. And that's why we're facing the crunch. So Booker's tasting. What do you guys think of this? What do you think? What do you taste? What's going on in this?
Well, let's talk about. So this release is 128.9 proof. It's 64.5% alcohol.
Yeah, it's a big boy. It's a beast. In that regard.
Totally.
Yeah.
So, got to kind of nose it at stride. It does jump out of the glass, and I have to admit, it smells really good.
Yeah, it does. It has a beautiful scent.
It's way more grassy. It's more like kind of hay and grass. And
Booker's is always a little bit drier for me. I mean, there's certain releases that are like nice and like sweet. Like the most recent like batch from last year that I love was the Mawmaw.
Mama's batch. Yeah.
Which was like, oh god, candied delicious goodness. It was like the sweetest Booker's I've ever had.
This is not sweet.
This is dry and nutty.
It's got a lot of leather and tobacco and
so there is variation.
But for me, this is just not a thing. Like, I wouldn't be that into this personally. It's not my, not my, this would probably be my, get the number five slot on my pick.
Yeah. At casks, like at proof, like just having out of the glass, like the flavors are really intense. They're pleasant, but there's just so much.
It's got a weird back of the mouth bite to it that I don't dig.
It's rough around the edges. Yeah. I mean, it's really like, I mean, it is unadulterated. Like, it's not forgiving at all. And it's not forgiving at all.
I drink a lot of high proof cask strength whiskey. And I just, there's something about this. There's like a same thing that I experience with certain scotches, though it's a totally different feel. But for me, it's sort of like the mouth feel is really important. And this just has something that on my tongue, in my mouth, I don't like. It's not even a flavor thing. It's like, it's just a texture
it's
quality.
It's not oily.
Right.
It's not oily. It doesn't have that coating.
That's true.
That you want with a high proof.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. For me, it's just a standard. It's just something that was always there. Like that old pair, like that, you know. Like a former lover or an old pair of jeans.
She was always there.
Yeah.
You could just call her up, 3A. Hey, what are you doing?
You know, it's like, what am I going to drink? What am I going to drink at the bar again? It's like, look, what if I walk over to my bar at home and grab a bottle, is it going to be Booker's every time? No. I mean, it's going to be Smooth Amber. It's going to be Elijah Craig.
Sure, but when you're out and about, you're not finding a Smooth Amber.
No. I mean, here and there, certainly not like most of the stuff that I'm going to reach for that I've stashed away. Booker's, she was always there for me, you know? She's at the end of the night, honestly, drunk.
She's like Brandy.
At that dive bar, and you just want one last cast strength blaster, like evening ender glass of whiskey, and there she was, winking at me from the bottom shelf, you know?
Winking at you from below deck.
Wow.
Oh, boy.
Well, she was already down there, so.
Yeah, while you're down there, love.
Might as well get in my glass.
And I'd always just look at her and say, Booker.
Still living your life after death. Every move I make. Every single day. Every time I pray. I'll be missing you. Thinking of the day. When you went away. What a life to take. What a bond to break. I'll be missing you.
From Smoky Beast headquarters in New York, New York, it's time to clear the shelves.
Wait, can I do like a Saturday Night Live intro of all the bottles that
yes,
we're doing?
Yes, sure.
Yes.
Please do. Featuring Elijah Craig 12 year, Smooth Ambler 7 year bourbon, Smooth Ambler 7 year rye, Daryl Hannah, Old Granddad 114, and your host for this evening, Bookers. All right, so we're back. Now we're gonna go around and kind of announce our most and least favorite of the five 2016 whiskeys that are going away for good. So Beast, what do you got for us? What's your druthers?
I'm gonna go Elijah Craig. I think that's my favorite of the bunch. Really round, buttery, nice, rich, sweet. Got everything I'm looking for. $32 or whatever we paid for that bottle. That's definitely what I've drank the most of, probably, with maybe exception of all the Smooth Amblers put together. But that particular bottle is my favorite. It's hard for me to find a least favorite. It's definitely not the Smooth Ambler Rye. That was my number two. I guess it's either the Booker's or the, I don't know, the Old Granddad. I don't know. I don't really have a least favorite. I like them all. But I'm going with Elijah Craig for the winner.
Ding, ding, ding. All right, Mr. Whiskey Warrior, what do you got for us, Jake?
My choice for what I would go find and clear the shelves for is probably the Old Granddad 114. Smooth Ambler is going to be back. They're going to keep producing delicious stuff. And I love them. The Elijah Craig 12 year is just too hard to find right now. I will admit the Elijah Craig 12-year was my winner for flavor profile of the night of all these whiskeys.
Okay, so two. I wasn't going for what to go
for.
I was just judging the whiskey on
so,
taste.
All right. So I think the winner of the like the most well-rounded whiskey of this evening is the Elijah Craig 12-year. I think it's delicious. It's extremely well-rounded. The bang for your buck on that is just, it's stupid how good that is for the money, honestly. I've drank some really fucking good whiskey. Mm-hmm. And like, I would happily come home to that every night.
Totally.
You know, my least favorite and my loser for the night is Booker's. Mm-hmm. And I'm a longtime Booker's advocate. I can't like go buy it, a couple bottles of it while it's at the price.
Sure.
Do whatever you want with it. Like make a couple great cocktails with it that are high proof. But don't buy it for $100. Spend your money elsewhere. But for me, I can tell you that I'm going to bunker for $25 a bottle.
Oh, I agree with you there.
Yeah.
To go out and clear the shelves. Maybe that should be our criteria, like the ultimate shelf clear. Maybe it should be Old Granddad. In terms of what I would, if I just had to pour a glass of any of these, it would be the Elijah Craig.
Yeah.
Yeah, personally, yeah.
What do you think, Ben? We need your votes here, Ben.
Yeah, sure. So I think for me, it's kind of clear. I'm going to agree that overall the 12-year Elijah Craig is probably my favorite. For me, if I'm stocking a bunker, I'm probably going to stock the Smooth Ambler Rye, just because I'm much more fond of rye. Right. So if I got to sit around for the rest of eternity or the rest of my short and pathetic bunker living life with some hooch, I'm going to stock the rye. And I actually really like this rye. Mm-hmm. But in terms of overall, I love the Elijah Craig. I agree on the what will you not really be able to find anymore. Like if they totally discontinue it, that Old Granddad is great. And for $25, like you're just not finding a better deal. So I think we kind of know where we're headed. It's like overall, Elijah Craig 12-year small batch. That's just our stuff.
Blind tasting, probably the best whiskey on the table. For the bunker buster, I think the Old Granddad is a winner.
The bang for your buck. Bang for your buck, bunker buster, fill it up, clear the shelves. I'd probably go for the Old Granddad. And
Smooth Ambler Rye is almost like if you see it, buy it. Both of those, the Elijah Craig and the Smooth Ambler.
It's going to be like a dinosaur.
Seafood diet.
We all agreed.
Sea bottle diet.
Like we agreed. This is not.
Yeah,
there's
that's
no,
good.
There's no verses here, man.
No,
this isn't a versus.
I know.
We'll come back with another battle. Don't you worry. I need my revenge.
That's it.
Clear the shelves.
Cool. All right. Well,
buy them all. Go buy them all.
Now you guys are armed with the knowledge necessary to clear the shelves. So go out there, start clearing the shelves. We want to wish you guys a very happy new year. Welcome in 2017. It can't be any more of a kick in the dick than 2016 has been.
Yeah.
We love you.
Thanks for giving us the holidays off, but we are coming back with some incredible events. The Beastmasters Club. We're going to have barrels coming, Four Roses.
Out the wazoo.
Out the wazoo.
We've got 2017 lined up like crazy. You guys are going to be in love.
We're going nuts. We're going to find a bigger room so more of you can come to our tastings. We're going to have some amazing guests, some amazing private barrels for sale. So please stay tuned and happy holidays.
Yeah. Thank you guys so much for supporting us thus far. We couldn't do it without you. We really appreciate all the love that we get. We appreciate that you come out. We appreciate that you're buying up the barrel bottles. And we're just hoping to do even better for you next year.
Signing up is free. Tell your friends.
All right. Cheers.
Thanks for having me on, guys.
Thanks, Warrior.
Bye-bye.
All right. Peace.
And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind. Never know.